Have you been advised surgery for your lumbar disc prolapse and you want to know what are the different ways in which a lumbar discectomy surgery can be done? Then this is the video for you. My name is Umesh Srikanta, presently working as a consultant and head of spine services at Aster Hospitals Bangalore. In this video, I'm going to talk on the various types of surgery available for treating a lumbar disc prolapse. Conventionally, a discectomy was done through an open surgery, where there used to be an incision of around 5 to 6 centimeters. The muscles were dissected from their attachments and a large portion of the bone was removed, a procedure that was called a laminectomy, to get access to the disc. Also, since this was done with a naked eye in olden times, so the visibility and lighting were impaired and the chances of nerve root or dural injury was higher. With the advent of a surgical microscope, however, the procedure could be done as a microlumbar discectomy, pretty much a standard in the last decade or so. So due to which the incision size became smaller, the visibility and the lighting became better, and outcomes significantly improved. However, this method still required the paraspinal muscles to be stripped from its attachments, and partial bone removal, that is what we call as a laminotomy, was still required to create the space or the access that was needed to get to the prolapsed disc fragment. Since the last 1.5 decades, improvements in surgical techniques have made it possible for spine surgeries to be done in a minimally invasive technique. Now, several procedures can be done with a tube that is as small as 16 millimeters in size. Not only does the incision become smaller, which is less than 2 centimeters, but also these tubes are inserted through the muscle by creating a track by serial dilatation, hence preserving the muscular attachments and causing minimal injury to the important structures of the spine. A much more refined technique being used in recent times is an endoscopic discectomy, which is one of the least invasive forms of doing a discectomy. Virtually the entire surgery is performed through an endoscope that is less than 1 centimeter in diameter, with incisions less than 1 centimeter in size. An endoscopic discectomy can be done from the back, similar way as we were doing a tubular discectomy, which is medically called the interlaminar endoscopic discectomy, or from the side, where the disc is approached through a natural opening in the spine, which is the foramen, thus avoiding any bone or ligament or muscle damage whatsoever. Needless to say, this form of discectomy is the least invasive, can be done under local anesthesia, and as a daycare procedure where patients can get discharged from the hospital on the same day and can resume their routine activities in 3 to 4 days' time. Well, however, there are some concerns about minimally invasive and endoscopic discectomies. Some people have misconceptions that in a minimally invasive discectomy, the job may not be done fully, since the area of visibility is less, since the tube is very small, and you may not be able to visualize the entire disc fragment. But that is only ignorance or inexperience speaking. The same amount of discectomy or decompression that can be done in an open or a microlumbar discectomy can also be done in a minimally invasive or an endoscopic fashion. The only difference here is the approach, which is through a tube or an endoscope, thus reducing injury to the innocent bystanders of the spine, that is the muscles and the ligament. By virtue of this reduced injury to the paraspinal structures, minimally invasive and endoscopic spine surgeries result in less blood loss, shorter hospital stay, lesser requirement for painkillers, smaller and cosmetic incision, and faster return to work or more normal activity. Hope this video clarifies your doubts on what are the surgical options that are available to treat a lumbar disc prolapse. For more such videos, subscribe to our YouTube channel, Spine 360. Thank you.